Will you get a taxi, Freddy? Do you want me to catch pneumonia?
I'm sorry, Mother. I'll get a taxi right away. Sorry.
So he's your son, is he? Well, if you'd done your duty by him as a mother should, you wouldn't let him spoil a poor girl's flowers and run away without paying.
Go on about your business, my girl.
Two bunches of violets trot in the mud.
Taxi! Taxi!
I say, Captain, buy a flower off a poor girl.
I'm sorry, I haven't any change.
I can change half a crown. Here, take this for tuppence.
I really haven't any. Oh, stop. Here's 3 halfpence, if that's any use to you.
Oh, thank you, Captain.
Here. You'll be careful. Better give him a flower for it. There's a bloke there behind the pillar taking down every blessed word you're saying.
I ain't done no harm by speaking to the gentleman. I have a right to sell flowers if I keep off the cab.
Right.
I'm a respectable girl, so help me. I never spoke to him except to ask him to buy a flower off of me.
What's all the blooming noise?
There's a tech taking her down.
Oh, sir. Don't let him charge me. You don't know what it means to me. They'll take away me character and drive me in the streets for speaking to a gentleman.
There, there, there. Who's hurting you, you silly girl? What do you take me for?
Oh, me Bible oath, I never said a word
yet. Shut up, shut up. Do I look like a policeman?
Well, what was you taking down me words for? How do I know you took me down right? You just let me see what you wrote about me.
Oh, go on, show her.
What's that? That ain't proper writing. I can't read that.
I can. I say, Captain, buy a fly off a poor girl.
Which calls I call him Captain. I bet now I'm out, sir. Don't let him lay a charge again before I work like that.
Charge? I make no charge. Really, sir, if you are a detective, you need not begin protecting me against molestation by young women until I ask you. Anybody could see the girl meant no harm.
He ain't a tech. He's a gentleman. Look at his boots.
And how are all your people down at Selsey?
Who told you my people come from Selsey?
Never mind, they do. And how do you come to be up so far east? You were born in Lisson Grove.
Wow! What harm is there in my life in Lisson Grove? It wasn't fit for a pig to live in. And I had to pay 4 and 6 a week.
Liver, you like him. Stop that noise.
Come, come. He can't touch you. You have a right to live where you please.
I'm a good girl, I am.
You know where I come from?
Hoxton.
Well, who said I didn't? My mate, you know everything, do you do?
Tell him where he comes from. You want to go fortune telling?
Cheltenham, Harrow, Cambridge, and India.
What? Right.
Blimey, he ain't a tech. He's a blooming busybody, that's what he is.
He ain't no gentleman not to interfere with a poor gal.
How do you do it, if I may ask? Simple phonetics, the science of speech. It's my profession. It's also my hobby. Anybody can spot an Irishman or a Yorkshireman by his brogue, but I can place a man within 6 miles. I can place him within 2 miles in London, sometimes within 2 streets.
Ought to be ashamed of himself, unmanly coward.
But is there a living in that?
Oh, yes, quite a fat one.
Let him mind his own business and leave a poor girl alone!
Woman, cease this detestable boo-hooing instantly, or else seek the shelter of some other place of worship.
I have a right to be here if I like, same as you.
A woman who utters such depressing and disgusting noises has no right to be anywhere, has no right to live. Remember that you are a human being with a soul and the divine gift of articulate speech. That your native language is the language of Shakespeare and Milton and the Bible. And don't sit there crooning like a bilious pigeon.
Ow!
Look at her, a prisoner of the gutters. Condemned by every syllable she utters. By right she should be taken out and hung for the cold-blooded murder of the English tongue.
Ow!
Yeah! Ooh, heavens, what a noise. This is what the British population calls an elementary education.
Come, sir, I think you picked a poor example.
Did I? Hear them down in Soho Square, dropping H's everywhere, speaking English any way they like. You, sir, did you go to school?
What are you taking me for, a fool?
Nobody taught him take instead of toik. Hear a Yorkshireman, or worse, hear a Cornishman converse. I'd rather hear a choir singing flat. Chickens cackling in a barn, just like this one.
Gion!
Gion! I ask you, sir, what sort of a word is that? It's ale and garn that in her place. Not her wretched clothes and dirty face. Why can't the English teach their children how to speak? This verbal class distinction by now should be antique. If you spoke as she does, sir, instead of the way you do, why, you might be selling flowers too.
I beg your pardon.
Englishman's way of speaking absolutely classifies him. The moment he talks, he makes some other Englishman despise him. One common language I'm afraid we'll never get. Oh, why can't the English learn to set a good example to people whose English is painful to your ears? The Scotch and the Irish leave you close to tears. There even are places where English completely disappears. In America, they haven't used it for years. Why can't the English teach their children how to speak? Norwegians learn Norwegian, their Greeks are taught their Greek. In France, every Frenchman knows his language from A to Z. Well, the French don't care what they do, actually, as long as they pronounce it properly. The Arabians learn Arabian at the speed of summer lightning, and the Hebrews learn it backwards, which is absolutely frightening. But use proper English, you're regarded as a freak. Oh, why can't the English? Why can't the English learn to speak? You see this creature with her curbstone English, the English that will keep her in the gutter to the end of her days? Well, sir, in 6 months I could pass her off as a duchess at an embassy ball. I could even get her a job as a lady's maid or a shop assistant, which requires better English.
Yeah, what's that you say?
Yes, you squashed cabbage leaf. You disgrace to the noble architecture of these columns. You incarnate insult to the English language. Yes. Yes, I could pass you off as the Queen of Sheba.
Taxi!
Oh, I say, Captain, you don't believe that, do you?
Taxi! Oh, anything's possible. I myself am a student of Indian dialects.
Are you? Do you know Colonel Pickering, author of Spoken Sanskrit?
I am Colonel Pickering. Who are you?
Henry Higgins, author of Higgins' Universal Alphabet.
I came from India to meet you.
I was going to India to meet you.
Higgins!
Pickering! Now, listen, where are you staying?
Oh, at the Carlton.
Oh, no, you're not. You're staying at 27A Wimpole Street. Come on with me. We'll have a jaw over supper. Eh?
Right you are.
Buy a flower coin, sir. I'm short for me lodging.
Liar, you said you could change half a crown.
You ought to be stuffed with nails, you ought! Here, take the old blooming basket for sixpence.
Ah, the church. A reminder. Now, Indian dialects have always fascinated me. I have records of over 50 of them.
Have you now? Do you know there are over 200?
Hey, shouldn't you stand up, gentlemen? We've got a blooming heiress in our midst.
Won't you be looking for a good butler, Eliza?
You won't do.
It's rather dull in town. I think I'll take me to Paris.
The missus wants to open up the castle in Capri.
Me doctor recommends a quiet summer by the sea.
Wouldn't it feel lovely?
Where are you off to this spring, Eliza? Be a Ritz!
All I want is a room somewhere, far away from the cold night air, with one enormous chair. Wouldn't it be lovely? Lots of chocolate for me to eat. Lots of cow making, lots of eat. Warm face, warm hands, warm feet. How wouldn't it be lovely?
of chocolate for me to eat. Lots of gal making lots of sweet. Warm face, warm hands, warm feet.
Now wouldn't it be lovely? Ow, sow, lovely, should absolutely still. Boy would never budge till spring crept over me windowsill.
Over me windowsill. Someone's head resting on my knee. Warm and tender as she can be. Who takes good care?
Running no charity bazaar drinks is to be paid for or not drunk. Oh, come on, Doolittle, out you get it now on the double.
Thanks for your hospitality, George. Send the bill to Buckingham Palace.
Ow!
Well, Alfie, I guess it's home we go.
Home? What do you want to go home for? Eliza should be along in a few minutes. She ought to be good for half a crown for a father that loves her.
Loves her? That's a laugh. You ain't been there for months.
What's that got to do with it? What's half a crown after all I've give her?
When did you ever give her anything?
Anything? I give her everything. I give her the greatest gift any human being could give to another, life. I introduced her to this here planet I did, with all its wonders and marvels. Ah, this lovely world, with the sun that shines and the moon that glows, with Hyde Park to walk through on a fine spring night, the whole ruddy city of London to roam about in selling her blooming flowers. I give her all that, I did, and then I disappears and leaves her on her own to enjoy it. Now, if that ain't worth half a crown now and again, I'll take off me belt and give her what for.
You got a good old, Alfie. But if you want that awful crowd from Eliza, you better have a good story to go with it.
Oh, Eliza, what a surprise.
Look, brass farthing.
Now, look here, Eliza. You wouldn't have the art to send me home to your stepmother without a bit of liquid protection, now, would you?
Stepmother. Stepmother, indeed.
Oh, I'm willing to marry her. It's me that suffers by it. I'm a slave to that woman, Eliza, just because I ain't her lawful husband. Come on, Eliza, slip your old dad half a crown to go home on.
Well, I had a bit of luck myself tonight. So here.
George! Three glorious beers!
But don't keep coming around counting on half crowns from me.
Good night, Eliza. You're a noble daughter. You see, boys, I told you not to go home. It's just faith, hope, and a little bit of luck. The Lord above gave man an arm of iron. since he could do his job and never shirk. The Lord above gave man an arm of iron, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, someone else will do the blinking work.
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit
of luck, you'll never work. Oh! The Lord above made liquor for temptation, to see if man could turn away from sin. The Lord above made liquor for temptation, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, when temptation comes, you'll give right in.
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, you'll give right in.
Or you can walk the straight and narrow, but with a little bit of luck, you run amok. The gentle sex was made for man to marry, to share his nest and see his food is cooked. The gentle sex was made for man to marry, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, you can have it all and not get hooked. Mark, mark,
with a little bit. With a little bit, with a little bit, I like you won't get up. With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of blooming love.
Hey! Hey! Show your face out there! How's a woman supposed to get a rest?
Well, I'm trying to keep them quiet, lady. Yeah, that's no way to talk to a lady.
That's we right, you
now, 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 boys, we've got to be neighborly like. For after all, the Lord above made man to help his neighbor, no matter where, on land or sea or foam. The Lord above made man to help his neighbor, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, when it comes around, you won't be alone. All together,
with a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit.
They're always throwing goodness at you, but with a little bit of luck, a man can duck. Oh, it's a crime for man to go philandering and fill his wife's poor heart with grief and pout. Oh, it's a crime for man to go philandering, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, you can see the blood and don't find out.
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, she won't find out. With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of blooming love.
Say, Higgins, couldn't we turn on the lights?
Nonsense, you hear much better in the dark.
But it's a fearful strain listening to all those vowel sounds. I'm quite done up for this afternoon.
Mr. Higgins, are you there?
Yes, what is it, Mrs. Pierce?
A young woman wants to see you, sir.
A young woman? What does she want? Has she an interesting accent?
Oh, something dreadful, sir.
Oh, well, let's have her up. Show her up, Mrs. Pierce.
Very well, sir. It's for you to say.
Now, this is rather a bit of luck. I'll show you how I make records. We'll get her talking, and I'll take her down in Bell's Visible Speech, and then later on in Broad Romic, and then we'll get her on the gramophone so you can turn her on whenever you like with the written transcript in front of you.
This is the young woman, sir?
Oh, no, 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 no. This is the girl I was jotting down last night. She's no use. No, I've got all the records I want of the Listen Grove lingo. I'm not going to waste another cylinder on that. No, be off with you. I don't want you.
Oh, don't be so saucy. You ain't heard what I come for yet. Did you tell him I come in a taxi? Nonsense, girl. What do you think a gentleman like Mr. Higgins cares what you came in? Eh, we are proud. He ain't above giving lessons, not him. I heard him say so. Well, I didn't come here asking for any compliment, and if my money's not good enough, I can go elsewhere.
Good enough for what?
Good enough for you. Now you know, don't you? I come to have lessons, I have, and to pay for them too, make no mistake.
What do you expect me to say?
If you was a gentleman, you might ask me to sit down, I think. Don't I tell you I'm bringing you business?
Pickering, should we ask this baggage to sit down, or should we throw her out of the window?
Ow! I won't be called baggage when I've offered to pay like any lady.
But what is it you want?
I want to be a lady in a flower shop. Instead of selling flowers at the corner of Tottenham Court Road. But they won't take me unless I can talk more genteel. He said he could teach me. Well, here I am, ready to pay. Not asking for any favour, and he treats me as if I was dirt. I know what lessons cost, and I'm ready to pay.
Oh, how much?
Now you're talking. I knew you'd come off it when you saw a chance of getting back a bit of what you chucked at me last night. You had a drop in, hadn't you?
Sit down.
Well, if you're going to make a compliment out of
it... Sit down!
What is your name?
Eliza Doolittle.
Won't you sit down, Miss Doolittle?
Oh, don't mind if I do.
Now, how much do you propose to pay me for these lessons, eh?
Oh, I know what's right. A lady friend of mine gets French lessons for 18 pence an hour from a real French gentleman. Well, you wouldn't have the face to charge me the same for teaching me my own language as you would for French. So I won't pay more than a shilling. Take it or leave it.
You know, Pickering, if you consider a shilling, not just as a simple shilling, but as a percentage of this girl's income, why, it works out as fully equivalent to 60 or 70 pounds from a millionaire. By George, it's the biggest offer I've ever had.
60 pounds? What are you talking about? I never offered you 60 pounds! Where would I get 60
pounds? Oh, hold
pounds?
Your tongue!
Cry, you silly girl, sit down. Nobody's going to touch your money.
But somebody is going to touch you with a broomstick if you don't stop snivelling. Now sit down.
Ah. One would think you was me father.
Oh, if I decide to teach you, I shall be worse than two fathers to you. Here.
What's that for?
To wipe your eyes, to wipe any part of your face that feels moist. Remember, that is your handkerchief and that is your sleeve. Don't mistake one for the other if you want to be a lady in a flower shop.
Higgins, I'm interested. What about your boast that you could pass her off as a duchess at the annual embassy ball? I'll say you're the greatest teacher alive if you can make that good. I'll bet you all the expenses of the experiment you can't do it. And I'll even pay for the lessons.
Ow, you're real good. Thank you, Captain.
It's almost irresistible. She's so deliciously low, so horribly dirty.
Dirty. I wash my face and hands before I come, I did.
I'll take it. I'll make a duchess out of this draggle-tailed guttersnipe. I'll start now, today, this very moment. Mrs. Pierce, take it away and clean her. Sandpaper, if it won't come off any other way. Is there a good fire in the kitchen?
Yes.
Well, take all her clothes off and burn them. Ring up and order some new ones and wrap her up in brown paper till they come.
You're no gentleman, you're not to speak of such things. I'm a good girl, I am, and I know what the like of you are, I do.
We want none of your slum prudery here, young woman. You've got to learn to behave like a duchess. Take it away, Mrs. Pierce. If she gives you any trouble, wallop her.
Ow! I'll call the police, I will.
But I've no place to put her.
Put her in the dustbin.
Ah!
Now, Higgins, do be reasonable.
You must be reasonable, Mr. Higgins, really you must. You can't walk over everybody like this.
I? Walk over everybody? My dear Mrs. Pierce, my dear Pickering, I had no intention of walking over anybody. All I propose is that we should be kind to this poor girl. Now, if I did not express myself clearly, it's because I did not wish to hurt her delicacy. Or yours.
But, sir, you can't take a girl up like that, as if you were picking up a pebble on the beach.
Why not?
Why not? But you don't know anything about her. What about her parents? She may be married.
Go on!
There, as the girl very properly says, go on.
Who'd marry? marry me.
Oh, by George, Eliza, the streets of London will be strewn with the bodies of men shooting themselves for your sake before I've done with you.
Yeah, I'm going. He's off his chump, he is. I don't want no balm he's teaching me.
Oh, indeed, madam. I very well, Mrs. Pierce, you needn't order the new clothes. Just throw her out.
Oh, stop, Mr. Higgins. I won't allow it. Go home to your parents, girl.
I ain't got no parents.
There you are. She ain't got no parents. What's all the fuss about? Girl doesn't belong to anybody. She's of no use to anybody except me, so take her upstairs.
But what's to become of her? Is she to be paid anything? Oh, do be sensible, sir.
But what on earth would she want with money? She'll have her food and her clothes. She'll only drink if you give her money.
You're a brute. It's a lie. No one ever saw a sign of liquor on me. Oh, sir, you're a gentleman. Don't let him talk to me like that.
Does it occur to you, Higgins, that the girl has some feelings?
No, I don't think so. No, not any feelings we need to bother about, have you, Eliza?
Mr. Higgins, I must know on what terms the girl's to be here. What's to become of her when you've finished your teachings? You must look ahead a little, sir. But
what's to become of her if we leave her in the gutter? You answer me that, Mrs. Pierce.
That's her own business, not yours, Mr. Higgins.
Well, then, when I've finished with her, we can throw her back into the gutter, and then it'll be her business again, so that's all right.
You have no feeling odd in you. You don't care for nothing but yourself. Yeah, I've had enough of this. I'm going.
Eliza, have some chocolates.
How do I know what might be in them? I've heard of girls being drugged by the like of you.
A pledge of good faith. I eat one half, and you eat the other. You shall have boxes of them, barrels of them. You shall live on them, eh?
I wouldn't have ate it, only I'm too lucky-like to take it out of me mouth.
Think of it, Eliza. Think of chocolates and taxes and gold and diamonds.
I'm a good girl, I am. I don't want no gold and no diamonds.
Higgins, I really must interfere. Mrs. Pierce is quite right. If this girl is to put herself in your hands for an experiment in teaching for 6 months, she must understand thoroughly what she's doing.
Yes. Eliza, you are to stay here for the next 6 months learning how to speak beautifully like a lady in a florist's shop. If you are good and do as you're told, you shall sleep in a proper bedroom and have lots to eat and money to buy chocolates and have rides in taxis. If you are wicked and idle, you will sleep in the back kitchen among the black beetles and be walloped by Mrs. Pierce with a broomstick. At the end of 6 months, you shall go to Buckingham Palace in a carriage, beautifully dressed. If the king finds out that you are not a lady, you will be taken by the police to the Tower of London, where your head will be cut off as a warning to other presumptuous flower girls. If you are not found out, you shall have a present of 7 and 6. To start life with as a lady in a shop. If you refuse this offer, you will be the most wicked, ungrateful girl, and the angels will weep for you. There, are you satisfied, Pickering? Could I speak more plainly or fairly, Mrs. Pierce?
Come with me, Eliza.
Thank you, Mrs. Pierce. Bundle her off to the bathroom.
You're a great bully, you are. I won't stay here if I don't like, and I won't let nobody wallop me.
Don't answer back, girl.
If I knew what I was getting myself in for, I never would have come up here. I've always been a good girl, and I won't be put upon.
Pickering, in 6 months, in 3, if she has a good ear and a quick tongue, I'll take her anywhere and I'll pass her off as anything. I'll make a queen out of that barbarous wretch.
Higgins, forgive the bluntness, but if I'm to be in this business, I shall feel responsible for the girl. I hope it's clearly understood that no advantage is to be taken of her position.
What, that thing's sacred, I assure you.
Oh, come now, Higgins, you know what I mean. This is no trifling matter. Are you a man of good character where women are concerned?
Have you ever met a man of good character where women are concerned?
Yes, very frequently.
Well, I haven't. I find that every time I let a woman become friends with me, she becomes jealous, exacting, suspicious, and a damn nuisance. And I find that the moment I let myself become friends with a woman, I become selfish and tyrannical. So, here I am, a confirmed old bachelor. And likely to remain so. After all, Pickering, I'm an ordinary man who desires nothing more than just the ordinary chance to live exactly as he likes and do precisely what he wants. An average man am I, of no eccentric whim, who likes to live his life free of strife, doing whatever he thinks is best for him. Just an ordinary man. But let a woman in your life, and your serenity is through. She'll redecorate your home from the cellar to the dome, then go on to the enthralling fun of overhauling you. Let a woman in your life, and you are up against a wall. Make a plan and you will find she has something else in mind. So then rather than do either, you do something else that neither likes at all. You want to talk of Keats or Milton? She only wants to talk of love. You go to see a play or ballet and spend it searching for her glove. Oh, let a woman in your life, and you invite eternal strife. Let them buy their wedding bands for those anxious little hands. I'd be equally as willing for a dentist to be drilling than to ever let a woman in my life. I'm a very gentle man, even-tempered and good-natured, whom you never hear complain, who has the milk of human kindness by the quart in every vein. A patient man am I, down to my fingertips, the sort who never could, ever would, let an insulting remark escape his lips. Just a very gentle man. But let a woman in your life, and patience hasn't got a chance. She will beg you for advice, your reply will be concise, she'll listen very nicely, then go off and do precisely what she wants. You were a man of grace and polish, who never spoke above a hush. Now all at once you're using language that would make a sailor blush. How let a woman in your life, and you are plunging in the knife. Let the others of my sex tie the knot around their necks. I'd prefer a new edition of the Spanish Inquisition than to ever let a woman in my life. I'm a quiet living man who prefers to spend his evenings in the silence of his room, who likes an atmosphere as restful as an undiscovered tomb. A pensive man am I, of philosophic joys, who likes to meditate, contemplate, free from humanity's mad inhuman noise. Just a quiet living man. But let a woman in your life, and your sabbatical is through. In a line that never ends comes an army of her friends, come to jabber and to chatter and to tell her what the matter is with you. She'll have a booming, boisterous family who will descend on you en masse. She'll have a large Wagnerian mother with a voice that shatters glass. Oh, let a woman in your life. Let a woman in your life. Let a woman in your life. I shall never let a woman in my life.
Come on, do little. Out you go. A bit now. I ain't running no charity bazaar.
Thanks for your hospitality, George. Send the bill to...
Yes, I know. Send me bill to Buckingham Palace now.
You can buy your own drinks now, Alfie Doolittle. Ooh, falling into a tub of butter you have.
What tub of butter?
Your daughter Eliza. Oh, you're a lucky man, Alfie Doolittle.
What are you talking about? What about Eliza?
He don't know. Her own father, and he don't know. Moved in with a swell, Eliza has. Left here in a taxi all by herself, smart as pint, and ain't been home for 3 days. And then I gets a message from her this morning. She wants a thing sent over to 27A Wimpole Street, care of Professor Higgins. And what things does she want? A bird cage and a Chinese fan. But she says, never mind about sending any clothes.
Well, I know she had a career in front of her. Hey, me boy, we're in for a booze up. The sun is shining on Alfred P. Doolittle. A man was made to help support his children, which is the right and proper thing to do. A man was made to help support his children, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, they'll go out and start supporting you.
With a little bit, with a little bit.
Working the girl this way, making her say her alphabet over and over from sun up to sundown, even during meals. When will it stop?
When she does it properly, of course. Is that all, Mrs. Pierce?
No, sir. The mail.
Pay the bills and say no to the invitations. Is that all?
No, sir. There's another letter from that American millionaire, Ezra D. Wallingford. He still wants you to lecture for his Moral Reform League.
Well, please throw it away, Mrs. Pierce.
But it's the third letter he's written you, sir. You should at least answer it.
Oh, very well. Leave it on the desk. I'll get to it.
Begging your pardon, sir, but there's a dustman downstairs to see you, an Alfred Doolittle. He says you have his daughter here.
Send the blackguard up.
He may not be a blackguard, Higgins.
Nonsense, of course he's a blackguard.
Well, whether he is or not, I'm afraid we shall have some trouble with him.
Oh, I think not. If there's any trouble, he shall have it with me, not I with him.
Doolittle, sir.
Professor Higgins.
Here, good morning.
What? Morning, Governor. I've come about a very serious matter, Governor.
Born in Hounslow, Mother Welsh. What do you want, Doolittle?
I want my daughter, that's what I want, see?
Well, of course you do. You're her father, aren't you? I'm glad to see you have some spark of family feeling left. She's here, upstairs. Take her away at once.
What?
take her away. You don't suppose I'm going to keep your daughter for you, do you?
Well, now, look here, Governor, look here. Is this reasonable? Well, is it fairity to take advantage of a man like that? The girl belongs to me. You've got her. Where do I come in?
How dare you come here and attempt to blackmail me? You sent her here on purpose.
Now, don't take a man up like that, Governor.
The police shall take you up. This is a plant, a plot to extort money by threats. I shall telephone the police.
Have I asked you for a brass farthing? I'll leave it to this gentleman here. Have I said a word about money?
Well, what else did you come here for?
Well, what would a bloke come for? Be human, Governor.
Alfred, you sent her here on purpose.
So help me, Governor, I never did.
Then how did you know she was here, eh?
I'll tell you, Governor, if you'll only let me get a word in. I'm willing to tell you. I'm wanting to tell you. I'm waiting to tell you.
No, Pickering, this chap has a certain natural gift for rhetoric. Observe the rhythm of his native wood notes wild. I'm willing to tell you. I'm wanting to tell you. I'm waiting to tell you. That's the Welsh strain in him. Now, how did you know Eliza was here if you didn't send her, eh?
She sent back for her luggage and I got to hear about it. She said she didn't want no clothes. Now, what was I to think from that, Governor? I ask you as a parent, what was I to think?
So you came here to rescue her from worse than death, eh?
Just so. That's right, Governor.
Mrs. Pierce, Eliza's father has come to take her away. Give her to him.
Wait a minute, Governor. Wait a minute. Well, you and me's men of the world, ain't we?
Oh, men of the world, are we? Mrs. Pierce, you'd better go.
I think so indeed, sir.
You know, Governor, I've taken a sort of fancy to you. And if you want the girl, I'm not so set on having her back home again. But what I might be open to is an arrangement. Well, all I ask is me rights as a father, and you're the last man alive to expect me to let her go for nothing. For I can see, you're one of the straight sort, Governor. And what's a £5 note to you, and what's Eliza to me?
I think you ought to know, Doolittle, that Mr. Higgins' intentions are entirely honorable.
Well, of course they are, Governor. If I thought they wasn't, I'd ask for 50.
You mean to say you'd sell your daughter for £50?
Have you no morals, man?
No. I can't afford them, Governor. And neither could you if you was as poor as me. Well, not that I mean any harm, mind you, but if Eliza's going to get a bit out of this, why not me too, eh? Well, look at it my way. What am I? I ask you, what am I? I am one of the undeserving poor, that's what I am. I think what that means to a man. It means he's up against middle-class morality for all time. If there's anything going and I puts in for a bit of it, it's always the same story. You're undeserving, you can't have it. But my need is as great as the most deserving widows that ever got money out of 6 different charities in 1 week for the death of the same husband. Well, I don't need less than a deserving man. I needs more. I don't eat less hardly than he does. And I drinks a lot more. I'm playing straight with you, Governor. I'm not pretending to be deserving. I'm undeserving. And I means to go on being undeserving. I likes it. And that's the truth. But will you take advantage of a man's nature to do him out of the price of his own daughter, what he's brought up, fed and clothed by the sweat of his brow, till she's grown big enough to be interesting to you too, gentlemen? Is £5 unreasonable? I puts it to you, and I leaves it to you.
You know, Pickering, if we were to take this man in hand for 6 months, he could choose between a seat in the cabinet and a popular pulpit in Wales. I suppose we better give him the £5, eh?
He'll make bad use of it, I'm afraid.
Oh, no, not me. Swell, Governor, I won't. No, just one good spree for myself and the missus, giving pleasure to ourselves and employment to others, and satisfaction to you to know it ain't being thrown away. You couldn't spend it better.
Oh, this is irresistible. Let's give him 10. Oh,
no, Governor, no. £10 is a lot of money, Governor. The missus wouldn't have the art to spend £10. Oh, makes a man feel prudent-like, and then goodbye to happiness. Nope. You give me what I ask for. Not a penny less, not a penny more.
I rather draw the line at encouraging this sort of immorality. Doolittle, why don't you marry that missus of yours? After all, marriage isn't so frightening. You married Eliza's mother.
Who told you that, Governor?
Well, nobody told me, but I concluded naturally that...
Pickering, if we listen to this man another minute, we shall have no convictions left. £5, I think you said.
Thank you, Governor.
I will. I won't say those rotty vows one more time.
Blimey, it's Eliza. Well, I never thought she'd clean up so good looking. She does me credit, don't she, Governor?
Yeah. What are you doing here?
You hold your tongue and don't you give these gentlemen none of your lip. If you have any trouble with her, Governor, just give her a few licks of the strap. That's the way to improve her mind. Well, good day, gentlemen. Cheerio, Eliza.
Oh, by George, there's a man for you. A philosophical genius of the first water. It's Mrs. Pierce. Write a letter to Mr. Ezra Wallingford and tell him if he wants a lecturer to get in touch with Mr. Alfred P. Doolittle. The common dustman, but one of the most original moralists in England.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what did he come for?
You say your vowels.
I know my vowels. I knew them before I come.
If you know them, say them.
I-E-I-L-U.
No. A-E-I-O-U.
That's what I said. I-E-I-L-U. I've been saying them for 3 days, and I won't say them no more.
I know it's difficult, Miss Doolittle, but try to understand...
Pickering, it's no use explaining. As a military man, you ought to know that drilling is what she needs. Much better leave her, or she'll be coming to you for sympathy. Oh,
very well, if you insist, but have a little patience with her, Higgins.
Well, of course. Say A.
You have no feeling odd in you.
A.
I.
A.
I.
A.
I.
A.
I.
Eliza. I promise you, you will pronounce your vowels correctly before this day is done. Or there'll be no lunch, no dinner, and no chocolates.
Just you wait, Henry Higgins, just you wait. You'll be sorry, but your tears will be too late. You'll be broke and I'll have money. Will I help you? Don't be funny. Just you wait, Henry Higgins, just you wait. Just you wait, Henry Higgins, till you're sick. And you scream to fetch a doctor double quick. I'll be off 1 second later and go straight to the theater. Oh, 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 Henry Higgins, just you wait. Oh, Henry Higgins, just you wait until we're swimming in the sea. Oh, Henry Higgins, and you get a cramp a little wise from me. When you yell you're gonna drown, get dressed and go to town. Oh, 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 Henry Higgins. Oh, 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 Henry Higgins. Just you wait. One day I'll be famous. I'll be proper and prim. Go to St. James so often, I will call it St. Jim. One evening the king will say, oh, Eliza, old thing, I want all of England your praises to sing. Next week on the 20th of May, I proclaim Eliza Doolittle Day. All the people will celebrate the glory of you, and whatever you wish or want, I gladly will do. Thanks a lot, King, says I, in a manner well bred. But all I want is Henry Higgins' head. Done, says the king with a stroke. Henry Higgins to the wall, and the king will tell me, The Rhine in spine stays mainly in the plain.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
Didn't I say that?
No, Eliza, you didn't say that. You didn't even say that. Oh. Every night, before you go to bed, where you used to say your prayers, I want you to repeat the rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain 50 times. You'll get much further with the Lord if you learn not to offend his ears. Now for your H's. Pickering, this is going to be ghastly.
Control yourself, Higgins. Give the girl a chance.
Yes, well, of course. Nobody expects her to get it right first time. Now, Eliza, watch very closely. Do you see this flame? Now, every time you say your H correctly, the flame will waver. And every time you drop your H, the flame will remain stationary. That's how you'll know you've done it correctly. And in time, your ear will hear the difference. Now, listen very carefully. In Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen. And I repeat after me. In Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen.
In Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen.
No, no, no. Have you no ear at all?
Should I do it over?
Oh, no, please, no. We shall have to start from the very beginning. Do this. Ha, 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 ha.
Ha, 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 ha.
Well, go on, go on. Does the same thing hold true in India, Pickering? Hey, this peculiar habit of dropping a letter like the letter H and then using it again where it shouldn't be, like saying ever instead of ever. You'll notice the same thing with Scandinavian people, you know, when they learn English. They have a tendency to do the same thing with the letter G, so they'll say singer instead of singer. And then they'll turn around and say linger instead of linger. How odd that is. Yes, I really must look that up. I wonder why that is. I wonder. Well, go on, go on.
Poor Professor Higgins, night and day he slaves away. Oh, poor Professor Higgins, all day long on his feet, up and down until he's numb. Doesn't rest, doesn't eat, doesn't touch a crumb.
Kind of you. Kind of you. Now listen very carefully, Eliza. How kind of you to let me come.
How kind of you to let me come.
No, no, no. Kind of you, kind of you. It's like cup of tea. Kind of you, cup of tea. Kind of you. Say cup of tea.
A cup of tea.
No. No, a cup of tea. A cup of tea. That's awfully good cake. I wonder where Mrs. Pierce gets it.
First rate of the strawberry tarts are delicious. Have you tried the plain cake?
I tried again.
Have you tried the...
No, no, Pickering. Eliza, try it again. A cup of tea, a cup of tea.
A cup of tea.
Can you not hear the difference? Push your tongue forward so that it squeezes against the top of your bottom teeth. Now, say cup.
Cup.
Now say of.
Of.
Now say cup, 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 of.
Cup, 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 of.
Yum, I say that was a glorious tea, Higgins. Finish that strawberry tart, I couldn't eat another thing.
Oh, no, thank you, old chap, really.
It's a shame to waste it.
Oh, it won't go to waste. I know somebody who's immensely fond of strawberry tarts. Here, birdie. Cheep, 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 cheep.
Higgins, poor Professor Higgins, on he plods against all odds. Oh, poor Professor Higgins, 9 p.m., 10 p.m., on through midnight every night, 1 a.m., 2 a.m., 3, 4, 5.
6 marbles, there you are. Now, I want you to read this and enunciate each word just as if the marbles were not in your mouth. with blackest moss the flower pots were thickly crusted, one and all. There you are. And each word clear as a bell. See?
I say, Higgins, are those pebbles really necessary?
If they are necessary for Demosthenes, they are necessary for Eliza Doolittle. Now try it again, Eliza. I cannot understand a word, not one word.
I say, Higgins, perhaps the poem is too difficult for the girl. Why don't you choose something simpler like The Owl and the Pussycat? That's a damn fine
Bickering!
Poem.
I cannot hear the girl. What's the matter? Why have you stopped?
I swallowed one.
Well, don't worry. I've got plenty more. Open your mouth.
Quit, Professor Higgins. Quit, Professor Higgins. Here on Clean or Pain Day, we will quit, Professor Higgins. Ain't not I, no, not how, pounding, pounding in our brain. Ain't not I, no, not how, don't I see rain.
Rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
I can't. I'm so tired. I'm so tired.
For God's sake, Higgins, it must be 3 o'clock in the morning. Do be reasonable.
I am always reasonable. Eliza, if I can go on with a blistering headache, so can you.
I have a headache too.
Oh, here. Look, Eliza, I know you're tired. I know your headaches. I know your nerves are as raw as meat in a butcher's window, but think what you're trying to accomplish. Think what you're dealing with. The majesty and the grandeur of the English language. It's the greatest possession that we have. The noblest sentiments that ever flowed in the hearts of men are contained in its extraordinary, imaginative, and musical mixtures of sounds. Now that's what you set yourself to conquer, Eliza. And conquer it, you will. Now, try it again.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
What was that?
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
Again?
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
I think she's got it. I think she's got it.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
By George, she's got it. By George, she's got it. Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain, on the plain.
And where's that soggy plain?
In Spain, in Spain.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain. The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain. In Hartford, Hereford and Hampshire,
hurricanes hardly happen. Let me come.
Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain, on the plain.
And where's that soggy plain?
It's me, it's me.
The rain stays mainly in the plain. Pickering. But we're making fine progress. You know, I think the time has come to try her out.
Are you feeling all right, Mr. Higgins?
Yes, quite well, thank you, Mrs. Pierce, and you?
Very well, sir, thank you.
Splendid, splendid. Now let's test her in public and see how she fares.
Mr. Higgins, I was awakened by a dreadful pounding. Do you know what it might have been?
Pounding? I heard no pounding, did you, Pickering?
No.
No, well, if this continues, Mrs. Pierce, you'd better see a doctor. I know. Let's take her to the races.
The races?
Yes, my mother's box at Ascot.
You'll consult your mother first, of course.
Yes, of course. No, let's surprise her. Yes. Now, come on, let's go straight off to bed. First thing in the morning, we'll go out and we'll buy her a gown. Eliza, get on with your work.
But, Mr. Higgins, it's early in the morning.
Well, what better time to work than early in the morning? At Pickering, where does one go for a lady's gown?
Oh, Whiteley's, of course.
How do you know that?
Common knowledge.
Is it? Oh. Well, look, we mustn't get her anything too flowery, eh? You know, I despise those gowns with a sort of weed here and a sort of weed there. You know, something simple, modest, and elegant is what's called for. Yes. Yes, perhaps with a sash. Hmm? Yes, just right.
You've all been working much too hard. I feel the strain is beginning to show. Eliza, I don't care what Mr. Higgins says. You must put down your books and go to bed. Bed, I couldn't go to bed. My head's too light to try to set it down. Sleep, I couldn't sleep tonight. Not for all the jewels in the crown. I could have danced all night. I could have danced all night and still have begged for more. I could have spread my wings and done a thousand things I've never done before. I'll never know what made it so exciting. Why all at once my heart took flight. I only know when he began to dance with me, I could have danced.
To be in bed.
I could have danced all night.
You must be dead.
I could have danced all night.
Your eyes are red.
And
now say goodnight.
Please turn out the light.
Please, it's really time for you to be in bed.
I could have spread my wings
and you're told
and done a thousand things. I've never done.
I'm sure it's fate.
If you'll catch a cold,
I'll never know. Made it so exciting. Why all at once my heart took flight. I only know when he began to dance with me.
And go to sleep.
If danced.
Time to sleep.
I could have danced all night. I could have danced all night and still have begged for more. I could have spread things I've never done before. I'll never know what made it so exciting.
Pickering, I don't understand. Do you mean that my son is coming to Ascot today?
Yes, Mrs. Higgins, as a matter of fact, he's here.
What a disagreeable surprise. Ascot is usually the one place I can come to with my friends and not run the risk of seeing my son Henry. Whenever my friends meet him, I never see them again.
He had to come, Mrs. Higgins. You see, he's taking the girl to the annual embassy ball, and he wanted to try her out first.
I beg your pardon?
You know, the annual embassy ball?
Yes, yes, I know the ball. What girl?
Oh, didn't I mention that?
No, you did not.
Oh, it's very simple, really. One night, I went to the opera at Covent Gardens to see one of my favorite operas, Aida. And as I was coming out, oh, incidentally, they didn't do Aida that night. No, they did Götterdämmerung instead. I'd never heard Götterdämmerung. By George, such a rackety one.
Yes.
Now, when this tenor chap...
Colonel, what about the girl?
Oh, yes. As I was coming out, I met your son Henry, who in turn met Miss Doolittle, who now lives with Henry.
Lives with Henry? Is it a love affair?
Heavens, no, she's a flower girl. He picked her up off the curbstone.
Flower girl?
Higgins said to me, Pickering, you see this girl? In 6 months I can make a duchess of her. I said, nonsense. He came right back with, yes, I can. All right, I said, I'll make a bet with you, you can't. And I did, and he is.
The horses are leaving the paddock, Mrs. Higgins.
Oh, excuse me, Mrs. Higgins, I must fetch her.
No, Colonel. Am I to understand that Henry is bringing a flower girl to Ascot?
Yes, Mrs. Higgins, that's it precisely. Jolly good, Mrs. Higgins, jolly good.
Charles, you'd better stay close to the car. I may be leaving abruptly.
What a frenzied moment's night was, didn't live in death, my exhausted face. Was a quick, absolutely, running on the asket, empty place. Thank you.
I don't know where the devil they could be. Oh, darling, there you are. Have you seen Pickering? Oh, you do look nice.
Yes, I have seen Colonel Pickering, and Henry, dear, I'm most provoked. Oh. I've heard that you're bringing a common flower girl from Covent Garden to my box.
Yes, but she'll be all right, darling. I taught her how to speak properly, and she has strict instructions as to her behavior. She's to keep to two subjects, the weather and everybody's health. Now, you help her along, you'll be quite safe.
Safe? To talk about our health in the middle of a race.
Well, she's got to talk about something.
Oh, Henry, you're not even dressed for Ascot.
I changed my shirt.
Where is this girl now?
Being pinned. Some of the clothes we bought, it didn't quite fit. See, I told Pickering we should have taken her with us.
Oh! You're a pretty pair of babies playing with your live doll. Ah, Mrs. Eynsford Hill.
Oh, damn, are all these people with you?
Mrs. Higgins, is that your celebrated son?
Yes, I'm sorry to say that my celebrated son has no manners. He may be the life and soul of the Royal Society soirees, but he could be rather trying on more commonplace occasions.
Ah,
Colonel Pickering, you're just in time for tea.
Thank you, Mrs. Higgins. May I introduce Miss Eliza Doolittle?
My dear Miss Doolittle.
How kind of you to let me come.
Oh, quite delighted, my dear. Mrs. Eynsford Hill, Miss Doolittle.
How do you do?
How do you do?
And Lord and Lady Boxington, Miss Doolittle.
How do you do?
How do you do?
And Freddie Eynsford Hill.
How do you do?
How do you do, Miss Doolittle?
Good afternoon, Professor Higgins.
The first race was very exciting, Miss Doolittle. I'm so sorry you missed it.
Thank you so much. Will it rain, do you think?
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain. In Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly happen.
How awfully funny.
What's wrong with that, young man?
I bet I got it right.
Smashing.
But I do hope we won't have any unseasonably cold spells. It brings on so much influenza.
Yes,
my whole family's susceptible to it.
My aunt died of influenza, so they say. But it is my belief they done the old woman in.
Done her in?
Yes, Lord love you. Why should she die of influenza when she come through diphtheria right enough the year before? Fairly blue with it she was. They all thought she was dead. But my father, he kept ladling gin down her throat. And then she came to so sudden she bit the bowl off the spoon.
Dear me.
Now, what call would a woman with that strength in her have to die of influenza? And what become of her new straw hut that should have come to me? Somebody pinched it. And what I say is, them as pinched it done her in.
Done her in? Done her in, did you say?
Yes, it's the new small talk. To do somebody in means to kill them.
Oh, surely you don't believe your aunt was killed.
Do I not? Them she lived with would have killed her for a hut pin, let alone a hut.
But it can't have been right for your father to pour spirits down her throat like that. It might have killed her.
Not her. Gin was mother's milk to her. Besides, he poured so
much of it down his own throat. He knew the good of it.
Do you mean to say that he drank?
Drank? My word, something chronic. Here, what are you sniggering at?
The new small talk. You do it so awfully well.
If I was doing it proper, then what was you laughing at? Have I said anything I oughtn't?
Oh, not at all, dear, no.
Well, that's a mercy, anyhow. What I always say...
I don't suppose there's enough time before the next race to place another bet, but come, my dear.
I'm afraid not, Colonel Pickering.
I have a bet on number 7. I should be so happy if you would take it. You'll enjoy the race ever so much more.
That's very kind of you.
His name is Dover.
Come on, Dover! Come on, Dover! Move your blooming ass!
Officer, I know this is Wimpole Street, but could you tell me where 27A is?
Right there, sir.
Oh, thank you. Excuse me, are those for sale?
Yes, sir. A shilling?
Here.
Thank you kindly, sir.
Isn't it a heavenly day? When she mentioned our aunt bit off the spoon, she completely done me in, and my heart went on a journey to the moon when she told about her father and the gin. And I never saw a more enchanting farce than the moment when she shouted, "Move your bloomin'!"
Yes, sir.
Is Miss Doolittle at home?
Whom shall I say is calling?
Freddy Ainsford Hill. If she doesn't remember me, tell her I'm the chap who was sniggering at her.
Yes, sir.
Oh, and would you give her these?
Yes, sir.
You needn't rush. I want to drink in the street where she lives.
Yes, sir.
I have often walked down this street before, but the pavement always stayed beneath my feet before. All at once am I several stories high, knowing I'm on the street where you live. Are there lilac trees in the heart of town? Can you hear a lark in any other part of town? Does enchantment pour of every door? No, it's just on the street where you live. And all the towering feeling, just to know somehow you are near. The overpowering feeling that any second you may suddenly appear. People stop and stare, they don't bother me, for there's nowhere else on earth that I would rather be. Let the time go by, I won't care if I can be here on the street where you live.
Mr. Ainsford Hill?
Yes.
I'm terribly sorry, sir, but Miss Doolittle says that she doesn't want to see anyone ever again.
But why? She was magnificent.
Magnificent? Do you have the right address, sir?
Of course. Tell her I'll wait.
But it might be days, sir, even weeks.
But don't you see? I'll be happier here.
People stop and stare, they don't bother me. For there's nowhere else on earth that I would rather be. Let the time go by, I won't care if I can be here on the street where you live.
Higgins, if there's any mishap at the embassy tonight, if Miss Doolittle suffers any embarrassment whatsoever, it's on your head alone. I've been begging you to call off this experiment ever since Ascot.
Eliza can do anything.
But suppose she's discovered? Suppose she makes another ghastly mistake?
There'll be no horses at the ball, Pickering.
Think how agonizing it would be. God, I don't know what I'd do if anything happened tonight.
You could always rejoin your regiment.
Higgins, this is no time for flippancy. The way you've driven the girl this last 6 weeks has exceeded all bounds of common... For God's sake, Higgins, stop pacing up and down. Can't you settle somewhere?
Have some port. It'll quieten your nerves.
I'm not nervous. Where is it?
Over there.
The car, Monsieur, sir.
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Pierce. Are you helping Eliza?
Yes,
thank
sir.
You.
Help her indeed. I bet that damn gown doesn't fit. I warned you about those French designers. We should have gone to a good English store where you'd know everybody was on our side. Have some port.
No, thank you.
It'll quieten your nerves.
No, thank you.
Are you so sure she'll retain everything you've hammered into her?
We shall see.
But suppose she doesn't.
Then I lose my bet.
You know what I can't stand about you, Higgins? It's your confounded complacency. In a moment like this with so much at stake, it's utterly indecent that you don't need a glass of port. And what about the girl? You act as if she doesn't matter at all.
Oh, rubbish, Pickering. Of course she matters. What do you think I've been doing all these months? What could possibly matter more than to take a human being and turn her into a different human being by creating a new speech for her? Why, it's filling up the deepest gulf that separates class from class and soul from soul. Oh, she matters immensely.
Higgins?
Not bad. Not bad at all.
Carrington. Professor Zoltan Carpathy. Colonel Hugh Pickering.
Mrs. Higgins. Well, she got by the first hurdle. The ambassador's wife was completely captivated.
Oh, I know. I've heard several people asking who she is. Do tell me what happened.
Well, Higgins said, Madam Ambassador, may I introduce Miss Eliza Doolittle?
Yes.
And Madam Ambassador said, how do you do? And Eliza came right back with, how do you do?
Is that all?
Oh, no. When it was my turn, both the ambassador and his wife said to me, Colonel Pickering, who was that captivating creature with Professor Higgins?
Ah, and what did you say?
I was stopped for a moment, but then I collected myself and I said, Eliza Doolittle.
That was very quick thinking, Colonel.
Thank you. Mrs. Higgins, do you think Eliza will make it?
Oh, I hope so. I've grown terribly fond of that girl.
Professor Henry Higgins.
Maestro! Maestro! You remember me?
No, I don't. Who the devil are you?
I am your pupil. Your first, best, and greatest pupil. I am Zoltan Carpathy, that marvelous boy.
Oh, yeah.
You teach me phonetics. I have made your name famous throughout Europe. You cannot forget me.
Yes, but my dear fellow, why all this hair? You look like a hedge. Maybe a little trim might be in order, won't you, sir?
I have not your imposing appearance, no. Your figure, your brow. Nobody notices me when I trim.
Yes, but what are all these old coins here?
Decorations for language.
Oh.
The Queen of Transylvania is here this evening. I am indispensable to her at these international parties. I speak 32 languages. I know everyone in Europe. No imposter escapes my detection. And now, Professor, you must introduce me to this glorious creature you have escorted this evening. She fascinates everyone. Not since Mrs. Langtry came to
London. His Excellency, Dr. Themistocles Stephanos.
This so-called Greek diplomat pretends he cannot speak English, but he does not deceive me. He is the son of a Yorkshire watchmaker. He speaks English so villainously as not to utter a single word of it without betraying his origin. But I help him to pretend, but I make him pay through the nose. I make them all pay! I look forward to meeting your lady.
I say, Higgins,
where's Eliza?
Oh, upstairs, last minute adjustments.
Higgins, I say, let's not risk it. Let's collect her and leave immediately.
Do you think it wise to stay, Henry?
Stay? Why ever not?
Miss Eliza Doolittle.
Ah, Professor, you must introduce me.
Majesty, the Queen of Transylvania.
Thank you.
Higgins, it was an immense achievement.
It was a silly notion. If I hadn't backed myself to do it, I'd have chucked the whole thing up 2 months ago.
Absolutely fantastic.
There's a lot of tomfoolery.
Higgins, I salute you.
Oh, nonsense, nonsense. Your silly people don't know their own silly business.
Tonight, old man, you did it, you did it, you did it. You said that you would do it, and indeed you did. I thought that you would rue it, I doubted you'd do it. But now I must admit it, that succeed you did. You should get a medal or be even made a knight.
It was nothing, really nothing.
All alone you hurdled every obstacle in sight.
Now wait, now wait. Give credit where it's due. A lot of the glory goes to you.
But you're the one who did it, who did it, who did it. As sturdy as Gibraltar, not a second did you falter. There's no doubt about it. You did it! I must have aged a year tonight. At times I thought I'd die of fright. Never was there a momentary lull.
Shortly after we came in, I saw at once we'd easily win. After that, I found it deadly dull.
You should have heard the oohs and ahs, everyone wondering who she was.
You'd think they'd never seen a lady before.
And when the Prince of Transylvania asked to meet her and gave his arm to lead her to the floor, I said to him, you did it, you did it, you did it. They thought she was ecstatic and so damned aristocratic, and they never knew that you did it.
Well, all I can say is, thank heavens for Zoltan Kabathi. If it hadn't been for him, I'd have died of boredom. He was there all right, and up to his old tricks.
Kabathi, the dreadful Hungarian, was he there?
Oh, yes. That blackguard who uses the science of speech more to blackmail and swindle than teach. He made it the devilish business of his to find out who this Miss Doolittle is. Every time he looked around, there he was, the hairy hound from Budapest. Never leaving us alone, never have I ever known a ruder pest. Finally, I decided it was foolish not to let him have his chance with her. So I stepped aside and let him dance with her. Oozing charm from every pore, he oiled his way around the floor. Every trick that he could play, he used to strip her mask away. And when at last the dance was done, he glowed as if he knew he'd won. And with a voice too eager and a smile too broad, he announced to the hostess that she was a fraud.
No.
Yavol. Her English is too good, he said, which clearly indicates that she is foreign. Whereas others are instructed in their native language, English people aren't. And while she may have studied with an expert dialectician and grammarian, I can tell that she was born Hungarian! Not only Hungarian, but of royal blood. She is a princess!
Ha! Congratulations, Professor Higgins, for your glorious
Well, all I can say is thank God it's all over. Now I can go to bed at last without dreading tomorrow.
Good night, Mr. Higgins.
Good night.
I think I'll turn into it. It's been a great occasion. Good night, Higgins.
Good night, Pickering. Oh, Mrs. Pierce. Oh, damn. I meant to tell her I wanted coffee in the morning instead of tea. Well, leave a little note for her, won't you, Eliza? Now, what the devil have I done with my slippers?
There are your slippers, and there, take your slippers, and may you never have a day's luck with them.
What on earth? What's the matter? Is anything wrong?
Nothing wrong with you. I've won your bet for you, haven't I? That's enough for you. I don't matter, I suppose.
You won my bet? You? You presumptuous insect. I won my bet. What'd you throw those slippers at me for?
Because I wanted to smash your face. I could kill you, you selfish brute. Why didn't you leave me where you picked me up out of, in the gutter? You thank God it's all over, and now you can just throw me back again there, do you?
Ooh, so the creature is nervous after all. Ah, claws in, you cat. How dare you show your temper to me? Now sit down and be quiet.
What's to become of me? What's to become of me?
How the devil should I know what's to become of you? What does it matter what becomes of you?
You don't care. I know you don't care. You wouldn't care if I was dead. I'm nothing to you. Not so much as them slippers.
Those slippers.
Those slippers. I didn't think it made any difference now.
Why have you suddenly begun to go on like this? May I ask if you complain of your treatment here?
No.
No. Has anybody behaved badly towards you? Colonel Pickering? Mrs. Pierce?
No.
No. Oh, if you don't pretend that I've treated you badly.
No.
No. Well, I'm really glad to hear it. Well, perhaps you're tired after the strain of the day. Have a chocolate.
No, thank you.
Well, I suppose it's natural for you to be anxious, but it's all over now. There's nothing more to worry about.
Nothing for you to worry about? Oh, God, I wish I was dead.
Why? In heaven's name, why? Oh, listen to me, Eliza. All this irritation is purely subjective.
I don't understand. I'm too ignorant.
Well, it's just imagination. Nobody's hurting you. Nothing's wrong. Now, you go to bed like a good girl and have a little cry. Say your prayers. That'll make you comfortable.
I heard your prayers. Thank God it's all over.
Well, don't you thank God it's all over? Now you're free. You can do what you like.
What am I fit for? What have you left me fit for? Where am I to go? What am I to do? What's to become of me?
Oh, that's what's bothering you, is it? Oh, I shouldn't worry about that if I were you. I should imagine you won't have much difficulty settling yourself somewhere or other. Though I hadn't quite realized you were going away. You might marry, you know. Yes. You see, Eliza, not all men are confirmed old bachelors like me and the Colonel. Most men are the marrying sort, poor devils. And you're not bad looking, you know. No, it's quite a pleasure to look at you at times. Not now, of course, because you've been crying and you look like the very devil, but... when you are yourself and are quite all right, you are what I should call attractive. Now, I dare say my mother could find some chap or other who would do very well.
We were above that at Covent Garden.
What do you mean?
I sold flowers. I didn't sell myself. Now that you've made a lady of me, I'm not fit to sell anything else.
Oh, tosh, Eliza. Don't insult human relations by dragging all that cant about buying and selling into it. You needn't marry the fella if you don't want to.
What else am I to do?
Well, lots of things. What about that old idea of the florist shop, eh? Pickering could set you up in one of those. He's got lots of money. He's going to have to pay for those togs you're wearing. Oh, come on. You'll be all right. Now, I really must clear off to bed. I'm devilishly sleepy. By the way, I was looking for something. What was it?
Your slippers.
Oh, yeah. Yes, of course. you shied them at me, didn't you?
Before you go, sir.
Eh?
do my clothes belong to me or to Colonel Pickering?
What the devil use would they be to Pickering? Why'd you have to start bothering about this in the middle of the night?
Because I want to know what I may take away with me. I don't want to be accused of stealing.
Stealing? Now, you shouldn't have said that, Eliza. That shows a want of feeling.
I'm sorry. I'm just a common, ignorant girl. In my station, I have to be careful. There can't be any feeling between the like of you and the like of me. Please tell me what belongs to me and what doesn't.
You may take the whole houseful, if you like. Except the jewels, they're hired. There. Does that satisfy you?
Stop, please. Will you take these to your room and keep them safe? I don't want to run the risk of their being missing.
Yeah, hand them over. If these belong to me instead of the jewelers, and I do, I'd ram them down your ungrateful throat.
This ring isn't the jewelers. It's the one you bought me at Brighton. I don't want it now.
Oh,
don't you hit me!
Hit you, you infamous creature! How dare you accuse me of such a thing? It's you who have hit me! You've wounded me to the heart!
I'm glad. I got a little of my own back anyhow.
You've caused me to lose my temper, a thing that has hardly ever happened to me before. I prefer to say nothing more tonight. I'm going to bed.
You'd better leave your own note for Mrs. Pierce about the coffee, for it won't be left by me.
Damn Mrs. Pierce. Damn the coffee, and damn you. And damn my own folly in having lavished my hard-earned knowledge and the treasure of my intimacy and regard on a heartless guttersnipe.
Stop and stare, they don't... Darling!
What are you doing here?
Nothing. I spend most of my time here. Don't laugh at me, Miss Doolittle.
Freddy, you don't think I'm a heartless gutter snipe, do you?
Of course not. How can you imagine such a thing? You know how I feel about you. I've written you 2 and 3 times a day, telling you sheets and sheets. Oh, darling. Speak, and the world is full of singing, and I am winging higher than the birds. Touch, and my heart begins to crumble, the heavens tumble, darling, and I'm yours.
Words, 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 I'm so sick of words. I get words all day through, first from him, now from you. Is that all you blighters can do? Don't talk of stars burning up above.
waste my time. Show me. Don't talk of tune, don't talk of fall, don't talk at all. Show me. Never do I ever want to hear another word. There isn't one I haven't heard. Here we are together in what ought to be a dream. Say one more word and I'll scream. Haven't your arms hungered for mine? Please don't explain. Show me. Show me. Don't wait until wrinkles and lines pop out all over my brow. Show me.
Darling, darling, wait.
Cecil. Oi. Time to go. Alfie. Look at Alfie.
Do come again, Mr. Doolittle. We value your patronage always.
Thanks, my good man. Here, take the missus a trip to Brighton.
Thanks again, Mr. Doolittle.
Father!
You see, Harry? He has no mercy. Sent her down here to spy on me and me misery, he did. Me own flesh and blood. Well, I'm miserable, all right. You can tell him that straight.
What are you talking about? What are you all dressed up for?
As if you didn't know. Go on back to your Wimpole Street devil and tell him what he done to me.
What has he done to you?
He's ruined me, that's all. Destroyed me happiness. Tied me up and delivered me into the hands of middle-class morality. And don't you defend him. Was it him, or was it not him, that wrote to an old American blighter named Wallingford that was giving $5 million to found moral reform societies and told him the most original moralist in England was Mr. Alfred P. Doolittle, a common dustman?
That does sound like one of his jokes.
Yeah, you may call it a joke. It put the lid on me right enough. The bloke died and left me £4,000 a year in his bloomin' will.
Come along, Alfie, in a couple of hours. We gotta be at the church.
Church?
Church, that's the deepest cut of all. What do you think I'm dressed up like a ruddy pallbearer? Your stepmother wants to marry me. Now that I'm respectable, she wants to be respectable.
Well, if that's the way you feel about it, why don't you just give the money back?
Oh, that's the tragedy of it, Eliza. It's easy to say chuck it, but I haven't the nerve. We're all intimidated. Intimidated, Eliza. That's what we are and that's what I am. Bought up. And that's what your precious professor has brought me to.
Not my precious professor.
Sent you back, has he? First, he shoves me into the middle class, then he chucks you out for me to support you. All a part of his plan. But you double-cross him, Eliza. Don't you come home to me. Don't you take tuppence from me. You stand on your own 2 feet. You're a lady now, and you can do it.
Eliza, it's getting frightfully cold in that taxi.
Oh, I say, you want to come see me turned off this morning? St. George's, Hanover Square, 10 o'clock. I wouldn't advise it, but you're welcome.
No thanks, Dad.
No.
Are you all finished here, Eliza?
Yes, Freddie. I'm all finished here. Good luck, Dad.
Come along, Alfie.
How much time do I have left?
There's just a few.
And girls all over London, and I've got to track them down in just a few more hours.
I'm getting married in the morning.
Ding dong, the bells are gonna chime. Pull out the stopper, let's have a whopper, but get me to the church on time.
I've gotta be there in the morning.
Spruced up and looking in me prime. Girls, come and kiss me. Show how you'll miss me, but get me to the church on time.
If I am dancing, roll on the floor. If I am whistling, me out the door. For I'm getting married in the morning.
Ding dong, the bells are gonna chime. Kick up a rumpus, but don't lose a compass and get me to the church. Get me to the church. For God's sake, get me to the church on time.
Morning. Ding dong, the bells are gonna chime.
Then
get me to the church on time.
Thank you.
at all, Miss
Pickering, Bates. Didn't she say where to send her clothes?
I told you, sir. She took them all with her.
What? What? Here's a confounded thing. Eliza's bolted.
Bolted?
Yes, bolted, and Mrs. Pierce let her go without telling me a thing about it.
Well, I'm dead.
Well, what am I to do? I got tea this morning instead of coffee. I don't know where anything is. I don't know what appointments I have.
Eliza would know.
Yes, of course she would, but damn it, she's gone.
Did any of you gentlemen frighten her last night?
You were there, Mrs. Pierce. We hardly said a word to her. Higgins, did you bully her after I went to bed?
Just the other way around. She threw the slippers at me. See, I never gave her the slightest provocation. The slippers came bang at my head before I'd even uttered a word. And she used the most awful language. I was shocked.
Well, I'm deaf.
I cannot understand it. She was shown every possible consideration. She admitted it herself.
Well, I'm dashed.
For God's sake, Pickering, stop being dashed and do something.
Well, what?
Well, I don't know. Telephone the police. What are they there for heaven's sake?
Mr. Higgins, you can't give Eliza's name to the police as if she were a thief or a lost umbrella.
Why not? I want to find her. The girl belongs to me. I paid £5 for her.
Quite right. Scotland Yard, please. May I have some coffee, Mrs. Pearson?
Yes, sir.
Oh, good morning, old chap. Colonel Hugh Pickering here, 27A Wimpole Street. Yes, I want to report a missing person. Anything you can do to assist in her recovery would be frightfully appreciated. Yes, I'm not without influence, and I'll see to it that your superior... What's that? Oh, Eliza Doolittle. Oh, about 21. I should say about 5'2". Her eyes...
Brown.
Oh, brown. Her hair? Well, it's a rather neutral, nondescript colour. I should say more on the...
Brown, brown, brown.
Well, you heard what he said. Brown. Yes, this is her residence. Between 3 and 4 in the morning. No relation. Let's just say a good friend, huh? Now, see here, my good man. What the girl does here is our business. It's your business to get her back so she can continue doing it.
What in all of heaven could have prompted her to go after such a triumph at the ball? What could have possessed her? What could have depressed her? I cannot understand the wretch at all.
Higgins, I've an old school chum up at the Home Office. Perhaps he can help. I'll give him a call. Whitehall 7244, please.
Women are irrational, that's all there is to that. Their heads are full of cotton, hay and rags. They're nothing but exasperating, irritating, vacillating, calculating, agitating, maddening and infuriating hags.
Brewster Budgeon, please. Yes, I'll wait.
Pickering? Huh? Why can't a woman be more like a man, eh? Yes. Why can't a woman be more like a man? Men are so honest, so thoroughly square, eternally noble, historically fair, who, when you win, will always give your back a pat. Why can't a woman be like that? Why does everyone do what the others do? Can't a woman learn to use her head? Why do they do everything their mothers do? Why can't they grow up, well, like their father instead? Why can't a woman take after a man? Men are so pleasant, so easy to please. Whenever you're with them, you're always at ease. Would you be slighted if I didn't speak for hours?
Of course not.
Would you be livid if I had a drink or two?
Nonsense.
Would you be wounded if I never sent you flowers?
Never.
Well, why can't a woman be like you? One man in a million may shout a bit. Now and then there's one with slight defects. One perhaps whose truthfulness you doubt a bit. But by and large we are a marvellous sex. So why can't a woman behave like a man? Men are so friendly, good-natured and kind. A better companion you never will find. If I were hours late for dinner, would you bellow?
Of course not.
If I forgot your silly birthday, would you fuss?
Nonsense.
Would you complain if I took out another fellow?
Never.
Well, why can't a woman be like us?
Hello.
Is Brewster Budgeon there? Boozy! You'll never, never, never guess who this is. Yes, it is. By George, what a memory. How are you, old fellow? It's good to hear your voice again. What's that? 30 years, is it really? Yes, there's a lot of water under the thing. Boozy, I'll tell you why I called. Something rather unpleasant has come up at this end. Could I come right over and see you? Yes. Thank you, Boozy. I'll be right there. I'm off to the Home Office, Mrs. Pierce.
Colonel Pickering, I do hope you find her. Mr. Higgins will miss her.
Mr. Higgins will miss her. Blast Mr. Higgins! I'll miss her.
Pickering! Pickering!
Oh, dash it, where's the Colonel?
He's gone over to the Home Office.
Ah! You see that, Mrs. Pierce? Now, I'm disturbed and he runs for help. Oh, now there's a good fellow for you. Mrs. Pierce, you're a woman. Why can't a woman be more like a man? Men are so decent, such regular chaps, ready to help you through any mishaps, ready to buck you up whenever you are glum. Why can't a woman be a chum? Why is thinking something women never do? Why is logic never even tried? Straightening up the hair is all they ever do. Why don't they straighten up, well, the mess that's inside? Why can't a woman be more like a man? If I were a woman, would been to a ball, been hailed as a princess by one and by all, would I start weeping like a bathtub overflowing and carry on as if my home were up a tree? Would I run off and never tell me where I'm going? No! Why can't a woman be like me?
Done this wonderful thing for them without making a single mistake. They just sat there and never said a word to you. Never petted you or admired you or told you how splendid you were.
Not a word.
That is simply appalling. I should not have thrown the slippers at him. I should have thrown the fire irons.
Mother! Mother!
Ah, I thought it wouldn't be long. Stay where you are, my dear.
Mother, where the devil are you?
Remember, last night you not only danced with a prince, you behaved like a princess.
Mother, the damnedest thing is... you?
How do you do, Professor Higgins? Are you quite well?
Am I quite well?
But of course you are. You're never ill. Would you care for some tea?
Oh, don't you dare try that game on me. I taught it to you. Now, get up and come home and don't be a fool. You've caused me enough trouble for one morning.
Oh, very nicely put indeed, Henry. No woman could resist such an invitation.
How did this baggage get here in the first place?
Eliza came to see me and I was delighted to have her. Huh. And if you can't promise to behave yourself, I shall have to ask you to leave.
You mean I'm to put on my Sunday manners for this thing that I created from the squashed cabbage leaves of Covent Garden?
Yes, dear, that is precisely what I mean.
I'll see her damned first.
Oh, how did you ever learn manners with my son around?
It was very difficult. I should never have learned how ladies and gentlemen behave had it not been for Colonel Pickering. He always showed me that he felt and thought of me as if I were something better than a common flower girl. You see, Mrs. Higgins, apart from the things one can pick up, the difference between a lady and a flower girl is not the way she behaves, but how she's treated. I shall always be a flower girl to Professor Higgins because he always treats me as a flower girl and always will. But I shall always be a lady to Colonel Pickering because he always treats me as a lady and always will.
Henry, please don't grind your teeth.
The vicar is here, ma'am.
Shall I show him to the garden?
Oh.
The vicar and the professor. Heavens no. I'll see him in the library. Eliza, if my son starts to break things, I give you my full permission to have him evicted. Henry, dear, if I were you, I should stick to two subjects, hmm? The weather and your health.
Well, Eliza, you've had a bit of your own bag, as you call it. Have you had enough? Are you going to be reasonable, or do you want some more?
You only want me back to pick up your slippers and put up with your tempers and fetch and carry for you.
I haven't said I wanted you back at all.
Indeed. Then what are we talking about?
About you, not about me. If you come back, I should treat you as I've always treated you. I can't change my nature, and I don't intend to change my manners. My manners are exactly the same as Colonel Pickering's.
No, they're not. He treats a flower girl as if she was a duchess.
And I treat a duchess as if she was a flower girl.
Oh, I see. The same to everyone.
Just so. Oh, the great secret, you see, Eliza, is not having good manners or bad manners or any other particular sort of manners, but having the same manner for all human souls. The question is not whether I have treated you rudely, but whether you've ever seen me treat anybody else better.
I don't care how you treat me. I don't mind your swearing at me. I shouldn't mind a black eye. I've had one before. But I won't be passed over.
Then get out of my way, for I won't stop for you. You talk about me as if I was a motor bus.
So you are a motor bus. All bounce and go and no consideration for anyone. But I can get along without you. Don't think I can't.
I know you can. I told you you could. You never wondered, I suppose, if I could get along without you.
Don't try to get around me. You'll have to get along without me.
Yeah, and so I shall, without you and without any soul on earth. But I shall miss you, Eliza. Now, I've learnt something from your idiotic notions. I confess that, humbly and gratefully.
You have my voice on your gramophone. If you get lonely without me, you can turn it on. It has no feelings to hurt.
I can't turn your soul on.
You are a devil. You can twist the heart in a girl as easily as some can twist her arm to hurt her. What am I to come back for?
For the fun of it. That's why I took you on.
And you can throw me out tomorrow if I don't do everything you want me to.
Yes, and you can walk out tomorrow if I don't do everything you want me to.
And go and live with my father.
Yes, if you like, or you can sell flowers, or would you rather marry Pickering?
I wouldn't marry you if you asked me. And you're nearer to my age than what he is.
Than he is.
I'll talk as I like. You're not my teacher now. That's not what I wanted, don't you think it. I've always had chaps wanting me that way. Freddie Hill writes me twice and three times a day, sheets and sheets.
Oh, in short, you want me to be as infatuated about you as he is that it?
No, I don't. That's not the sort of feeling I want from you. I want a little kindness. I know I'm a common, ignorant girl and you're a book-learned gentleman, but I'm not dirt under your feet. What I did wasn't for the dresses and the taxis. I did it because we were pleasant together, and I came to care for you. Not to want you to make love to me, and not forgetting the difference between us, but more friendly-like.
Well, of course. That's just how I feel. And how Pickering feels. Oh, Eliza, you're a fool.
That's not the proper answer to give me.
Well, it's the only one you'll get until you stop being a plain idiot. Oh, if you want to be a lady, you're going to have to stop feeling neglected. If the men you know don't spend half their time snivelling over you and the other half giving you black eyes. You find me cold, unfeeling, selfish, don't you? Very well, then, be off with you to the sort of people you like. Marry some sentimental hog or other with lots of money and a thick pair of lips to kiss you with and a thick pair of boots to kick you in. If you can't appreciate what you've got, then you better get what you can appreciate.
If I can't have kindness, I'll have independence.
Independence? Oh, ho, ho. That's middle-class blasphemy.
I can't talk to you. You turn everything I say against me. I'm always in the wrong. But don't be too sure you have me under your feet to be trampled on and talked down. I'll marry Freddy. I will, just as soon as I'm able to support him.
Freddy! That poor devil who couldn't get a job as an errand boy even if he had the guts to try for it. Oh, woman, do you not understand I've made you consort for a king?
Freddy loves me. That makes him king enough for me. I don't want him to work. He wasn't brought up to it as I was. I'll go and be a teacher.
What will you teach in heaven's name?
What you taught me. I'll teach phonetics.
Ha, ha, ha.
I'll go and offer myself as an assistant to that brilliant Hungarian.
What? That imposter, that humbug, that toadying ignoramus? You teach him my methods, my discoveries. You take one step in that direction, I'll wring your neck, do you hear me?
Ring away! What do I care? I knew you'd strike me one day. That's done you in, Henry Higgins it has. Now I don't care that for your bullying and big talk. What a fool I was! What a dominated fool to think you were the earth and sky. What a fool I was! What an addle-beaded fool! What a mutton-headed dolt was I! No, my reverberating friend, you are not the beginning and the end.
An impudent hussy. There's not an idea in your head or a word in your mouth that I haven't put there.
There'll be spring every year without you. England still will be here without you. There'll be fruit on the tree and a shore by the sea. There'll be crumpets and tea without you. Art and music will thrive without you. Somehow Keats will survive without you. And there still will be rain on that plain down in Spain. Even that will remain without you. I can do without you. You, dear friend, who talk so. They can still rule the land without you. Windsor Castle will stand without you. And without much ado, we get all muddled through without you.
Brazen wretch.
Without your pulling it, the tide comes in. Without your twirling it, the earth can spin. Without your pushing them, the clouds roll by. They can do without you, ducky, so can I. I shall not feel alone without you. I can stand on my own without you. So go back to your shell. I can do bloody well without...
George, I really did it. I did it. I did it. I said I'd make a woman, and indeed I did. I knew that I could do it. I knew it. I knew it. I said I'd make a woman and succeed. I did. Oh, Eliza, you are magnificent. Oh, 5 minutes ago, you were a millstone round my neck. Now, you're a tower of strength, a consort battleship. Oh, I like you like this.
Goodbye, Professor Higgins. I shall not be seeing you again.
Mother! Mother!
What is it, Henry? What's happened?
She's gone.
Well, of course, dear. What did you expect?
What am I to do?
Do without, I suppose.
Yes, and so I shall. Yes. If the Higgins oxygen burns her little lungs, let her seek some stuffiness that suits her. She's an owl, blinded by a few days of my sunshine.
No, let her go. I can do without her. I can do without anybody. I have my own soul, my own spark of divine fire.
Bravo, Eliza!
Damn, 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 damn! I've grown accustomed to her face. She almost makes the day begin. I've grown accustomed to the tune. She whistles night and noon. Her smiles, her frowns, her ups, her downs are second nature to me now. Like breathing out and breathing in. I was serenely independent and content before we met. Surely I can always be that way again. And yet, I've grown accustomed to her looks, accustomed to her voice, accustomed to her face. Marry Freddy. Oh, what an infantile idea. What a heartless, wicked, brainless thing to do. And she'll regret it. She'll regret it. It's doomed before they even take the vows. Yes. I can see her now, Mrs. Freddy Eynsford Hill, in a wretched little flat above a store. I can see her now, not a penny in the till, and the bill collectors beating at the door. She'll try and teach the things I taught her, and end up selling flowers instead, begging for her bread and water, while her husband has his breakfast in bed. Ah! In a year or two, when she's prematurely grey and the blossom in her cheek has turned to chalk, she'll come home and lo, he'll have upped and run away with a social climbing heiress from New York. Oh, poor Eliza! How simply frightful! How humiliating! How delightful! And now how poignant it will be on that evil night. She hammers on my door in tears and rags, miserable and lonely, repentant and contrite. Shall I take her in or throw her to the wolves? Give her kindness or the treatment she deserves? Shall I take her back or throw the baggage out? I'm a most forgiving man, the sort who never could, ever would, take a position and staunchly never budge. Just a most forgiving man. But I shall never take her back. If she were crawling on her knees, let her promise to atone, let her shiver, let her moan, I shall slam the door and let that hellcat freeze. Marry Freddy! Ha! I'm so used to hear her say, good morning, every day. Her joys, her woes, her highs, her lows are second nature to me now. Like breathing out and breathing in. I'm very grateful she's a woman, and so easy to forget. Rather like a habit you can always break. Yet, I've grown accustomed to the trace of something in the air, accustomed to
to her face.
Before I come, I did.
Eliza, where the devil are my slippers?